I'm Susie Goodwin, the host of Run Lift Mom, and as most of you know, I am a Zaya Active independent representative. This summer, we are celebrating our four pillars: activity, community, uplift, and light. We're doing everything we can to exemplify these pillars, and we hope this episode of Run Lift Mom inspires you to join us because it is about activity. Welcome to the Run Lift Mom podcast, where we're talking about running, lifting, and momming, not necessarily in that order. Today, I have for you Anne Marie Cody. Anne Marie is a NASA astronomer, athlete, and the mom of three. That's right, she's a triplet mom living in the San Francisco Bay Area of California. She's competed nationally in rowing and orienteering, and then more recently, she has taken up stroller running, which is what initially connected us. She has owned the Guinness World Record for the fastest half marathon pushing a triple pram, and she's the current holder of the Guinness World Record for the fastest marathon pushing a triple pram. She also has a similar record pending at the 10K distance. Professionally, Anne Marie works for the Kepler and K2 missions, which hunt for planets around other stars using data from NASA's Kepler Space Telescope. You guys, this woman is the real deal. She's the total package. Without further ado, my friend and Guinness World Record holder, Anne Marie Cody. All right. Hi, Anne Marie. Welcome to the Run Lift Mom podcast.
Thank you.
I am so excited to have you here. Not only are you a triplet mom, you are have owned multiple and own multiple as well as pending Guinness World Records. You're a very accomplished athlete. I want you, though, to start with, so everybody knows, you're a triplet mom and you're an accomplished runner. Can you talk to me a little bit about why and how you found running?
Sure. You know, I actually found running from a very young age. I grew up in this tiny town in the middle of Massachusetts that no one's heard of. It's called Harvard, no association with the university. But out of that tiny town came an amazing Olympic runner. Her name is Lynn Jennings. I don't know if you've heard of her.
Yes.
She went to my high school. And she ran on my high school cross country team in the late 70s when there were no girls running cross country. And so she, when I moved to that town at age 10, I started walking home from school every day, and the high school cross country team was doing their practice and they would run by me. And of course, Lynn Jennings was out, you know, getting world cross country championships at that point. But I associated that team and her with running. And not only that, but these kids would go by me and I was like, wow, that looks really fun. So as soon as I was eligible, that was in seventh grade when I was 12 years old, I started going to that school and I was like, I got to join this team.
Why not? Is so cool. I mean, we'll dip back into your experience, but I want to pause here because I've had a lot of moms on this show and something in common that everyone has is they modeled healthy behaviors were modeled for them and they model healthy behaviors for their kids. And I love that that's where it really began with you as well.
Yeah. And it was so fun. I mean, honestly, it was more than just running, like being on a team and everything like that was my social outlet. And so I just started to associate running with fun times.
Very cool. So then into adulthood, I mean, you're a triplet mom. So did you run in adulthood prior to that pregnancy with multiples?
Well, you know, I never really did competitive running in terms of road racing. I did a little bit of trail running. I mostly did it just recreational, you know, go out, enjoy myself. And so after college, I had some injuries that frustrated me, and I won't say I gave up on running, but I didn't really have any ambitions because of those injuries. And I got into rowing as a result because that's low impact. And I really enjoyed rowing. I did it for about 5-6 years after college. And then I got tired of getting up at 5:30 in the morning. I'm not really a morning person, which I know sounds weird for a mom, but I'm still not a morning person. And
I bet there are a lot of people that can relate to that, because listeners of this podcast hear me talk about my alarm going off at 4:30, and I know 75% of them roll their eyes every time I say it.
Yeah, so I did rowing. I still want to get back to rowing, but I couldn't hack the schedule.
And, okay.
And then I got into another sport, which does involve running, but it's not road racing. It's called orienteering. And if you haven't heard of that, it's a combination of cross-country running or hiking. You can do it at whatever pace, and map navigation. They call it the thinking sport because it's not all about going fast. It's about getting from point A to point B in the wilderness via whatever route you choose. So I was running, but the focus wasn't on like trail races or road races. And I did that right up until the time when the triplets were born, actually. And I still do it occasionally. And it's another thing I want to get back to. It's just hard to take two-year-olds to a wilderness orienteering meet at this point when they're maybe four. I think they'll be able to actually do it themselves, but it's been on hold while I do mostly road running and stroller pushing.
Well, we preach seasons of life, and it does not surprise me to hear that the astronomer is attracted to the thinking woman's sport. Yeah. So talk to me a little bit about stroller running. Can you tell me at the, you know, recording of this podcast, we're knocking on June 2019. How old are your triplets, and when did you start running with them?
My triplets just turned 2.5. We're in the middle of the terrible twos.
Terrible twos times three. See, now here's where I can relate to you, Anne-Marie.
So they were born 2.5 years ago. That puts us around Thanksgiving of 2016. And prior to having them, I couldn't run much because I was carrying three babies. I did try. I ended up doing some hiking until the very end, but running, that was a bit painful. Not to mention it scared by doctors.
Right.
And then I wanted to try some running after, but unfortunately I had become super anemic during the pregnancy, and the combination of that and giving birth and everything, I had like way too few blood cells to even walk around for like a month. Like I would stand up and just huff and puff and have to sit down. But I wasn't too frustrated because I had other things to think about, like the fact that I had three babies, right? So I wasn't really thinking about running.
You know, there's that. If we did sound effects in this podcast, this is where I would do the drum cymbals because it sounds like a punchline. You know, other things. Yeah.
But I got over that, and I kind of got into the routine of having three newborns, and I started to think about running. But then the new problem was I had all this pain. Like my pelvic joint was just way too mobile, which is not a surprise because stuff loosens when you're pregnant, and when you have three, like everything expands. Mm-hmm. So I could not run without pain, and I went to PT, but of course I had zero time to do PT exercises. So I did that for about 6 months until I was able to run with the help of a support belt, pain-free. So I went a long time without running, and that was hard for me, because I enjoy running a lot. And I was looking for some goal or something to motivate me to get through the tough times, both with taking care of three newborns, some kind of outlet, but also the fact that I couldn't really run without pain for a while.
Right.
And, you know, initially, right before I had the babies, some friends said, you know, oh, we should get some money to get Anne-Marie a triple jogging stroller. You know, she loves running. She's totally going to do this. And it's funny because you know what my reaction was? It's not what you would think. I was like, I don't want one of those things. It's totally inconvenient. It doesn't fit on the sidewalk. When the heck am I going to use that? No, I want practical stuff.
And says the woman who now owns and has owned multiple Guinness World Records. That is pretty funny to hear. But you're in the San Francisco area, right?
That's correct.
So you're probably thinking space as well.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, we moved recently, but we were in a not too large 2-bedroom apartment on a second floor with a stairway. It did have a garage, but there's not much space in the garage because we're sharing it with four other apartments. And When the kids were born, we had a compact car. So we put three car seats across the back, and us adults rode in the front. The stroller, these triple strollers, they don't fit in the trunk of a compact car. So right. I was like, what is the point of that? I don't want one. Thanks, friends, for the good idea, but, you know, please get me diapers instead.
For listeners, and we've talked about this in the episode with Pi Bell and Sherry Armitage, they're quad moms. We've talked about the different multiple running strollers, i.e. beyond a double. The triple is probably about, what would you say, about 3.5-4 feet wide. I want people to picture this as they're listening.
I've measured it at 4 feet.
All right. 4 feet wide, and she's driving a compact car. Continue on.
Well, so eventually we realized that in order to have family visit and to go anywhere outside of the neighborhood, we needed a minivan. but let's back up a moment, because before the minivan ever arrived on the scene, we lasted 6 months with the compact car, actually.
Wow.
But
literally until the wheels fall off.
Yeah. And, you know, I got this idea planted in my head that maybe I should try running with a stroller, because I was looking for ways to get the babies to relax. And we didn't really have any way to take them around the neighborhood. We didn't have any kind of triple stroller whatsoever. We had a double with which the car seats latched into, and then I would carry the third kid on my chest. And I guess after a while I decided, you know, when it gets warm, this is not going to work, because it can get pretty hot in California. So I think that's sort of what got me thinking. And then we also, for a time, had a nanny. And the nanny was just like, I am not going to push a double stroller and carry a third child. Like, this is not happening. So I thought, okay, I need a triple stroller. And so I looked into the ones that are not meant for jogging, that are three in a line, like a train. But the kids weren't even 6 months old, and those didn't really lean far back enough. When babies don't have so much head support, you know, they need to recline a fair amount. Right. And so I was almost going to buy one of those, and then I suddenly thought, maybe I should get a jogging stroller. And I realized that a lot of those do recline pretty far. Mm-hmm. And I had it in the back of my head that this other triplet mom, who happens to be named Susie Goodwin, had set a Guinness World Record doing a half marathon. And suddenly, I don't know at what point this was, but something clicked. It was like, you know, I never thought of racing with my new triplets, but that would be a pretty cool goal, to actually do a half marathon with them in a triple stroller. And so
if folks are timelining this, we set our Guinness record, because we created the category and set the record. That was it was November 2016. So this is right around the time
when they were born. And I saw it in the news, and my triple group said, "Hey, look at this, guys." And I was like, "Wow, that is so cool. I didn't even know that was a thing." And so I had that in the back of my head. I didn't really take it seriously for a while, but, you know, when I was considering which stroller to get, it kind of pushed me in the direction of getting the inconveniently large jogging stroller. But of course, the problem is, where do you get one of these? They're not really sold in stores at this point. There's such a small market. And so I started looking on Craigslist and things like that, and I couldn't find one. I found a triplet mom in Texas, but she just couldn't figure out how to ship it to me, because the thing weighs, you know, 60, 70 pounds.
Yeah.
I gave up on that. And then I found one in the LA area, actually. And I used to live in LA, so, you know, I was familiar with the area. But again, you know, I wasn't – how are they supposed to send it up from LA? So it just so happened that in I think it was March or April of 2017, my husband had an opportunity to go down to the LA area, because he's involved in some mountain search and rescue stuff. And there was a big event happening down there, which he really wanted to go to. And at first I was like, no, we have newborn triplets. You can't ditch me and go to LA for 3 days. And then all of a sudden I found out that there was one of these massive triple strollers.
Now you can go. You need to acquire this stroller.
I was like, you know what? I've had a change of heart. You can go. And he was like, what? And I said, But there's a condition. I knew it. There's a condition. You have to come back with this triple stroller. And so we joke, but it's the stroller that he drove 1,000 miles for. And remember, we still didn't have the minivan at this point. So how is he even going to get it back, right? So he went by himself with the compact car. He got the stroller, tested it out. It worked well. And he put it in the back seat. We took all the car seat mounts out, everything.
Wow.
And the stroller took up the entire back seat of the car.
Now, by this point in Facebook Messenger, you and I have connected with another triplet mom, and we're talking a little bit about stroller running. I know you had toyed around with the idea of breaking the record, so if folks are listening, this was the half marathon record at the time, and we had exchanged some, like, hey, girl, this is how you want to go at it as far as your application yeah. with Guinness, kind of some best practices. I'm definitely fast-forwarding a little bit, but can you tell me a little bit about preparing for that initial race, running yeah. with the triplets, and then that race? Because we know there are more records to come after that one, but I feel blessed that we were connected through that.
Yeah. Well, you know, yeah, I knew nothing about the Guinness process, so you gave me a lot of really helpful information. And you know, my first task was just getting back on my feet, and that happened in June of 2017. We took a nice trip to the seaside, and there was a paved bike path along the Pacific Ocean there, really gorgeous. My mother-in-law was visiting, and I said, hey, why don't you and your mom take a walk, and I'm going to try jogging with this thing and just see what happens. And I took off with it along this path with, you know, lots of walkers and bikers. And of course, the first reaction I get is, what is this? You know, this huge stroller, what the heck?
So wait, but you didn't have the kids in it? You just took the stroller?
Oh, no, I did have the kids.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right, jump in the deep end, girl. Keep going.
What is going on here? And I got all these reactions, which I was kind of put off by. By now, I'm very used to it. But we went 6 miles, and I was like, gosh, this is so fun.
You would think if you go into the wild with a triple jogging stroller, right, and you're legit running with it, you would think that it's like a Tupac sighting, okay, y'all? Yes. Like, people lose their minds.
Yes, then that is what I found out. Now, that was not the fun part for me. I was kind of like, I was a little shy about the whole thing, but just the feeling of pushing this thing, and I still use it. It's a very high quality stroller that has like a smooth glide feeling to it. I understand not all of them feel like that. So even though I'm pushing at this point like 110 pounds, it felt good. And I think part of it is because I used to be a rower. When you row, people think it's like an arm sport, but it's not. You're using your upper legs and your lower back, your core, and you're pushing something heavy, which is a boat. And in this case, I was using a lot of those same muscles to push something heavy. And it was kind of like, oh, I found something new and cool, and it feels really good.
But it's a stroller. Now, your original intention to get into running was maybe to help calm them down a little bit. Did you find yeah. on that run that hit the mark, or did it take you guys a little bit of practice?
Oh, yes. Yes. So another motivation, and it remains to this day, is that once we passed the newborn stage, I could not figure out how to get my three kids to nap in their cribs simultaneously at home. Mm-hmm. You would think I would have this all figured out, but to this day, they just won't do it. But if they're moving, i.e. in the car or in the stroller, I can get them all to take a nap. And that became our lifeline, that stroller.
We talk about finding your why pretty often. And, you know, something I would normally ask a guest is, hey, why not just hire a babysitter or get a treadmill? But you're syncing it right there with your why. It's to get them to nap, you guys. It's
yeah.
for sanity. Awesome.
Yeah. I mean, it could be. We have found that babysitters are more successful at getting them to nap than we parents are. But that's really expensive in our area. and it's a win-win thing. Mommy wants to run. The kids need to sleep. I get peace. Like, this is my sanity time now with the running with the stroller. You know, I don't care if people laugh at us, say, whoa, what's that? Like, I get peace and quiet and scenery and fresh air, and the kids get a nap, and it's just perfect.
Now, Anne-Marie, when you did go on to break the Guinness World record half marathon pushing a triple pram, I mean, real talk, it was 14 minutes faster than I did it, okay? So I'm wondering, at this point, when you're on run number one, were you just fast right out of the gates, or did you have to work up to the speed that you have now acquired with this stroller?
Yeah, you know, that was, I had, I guess, a lot of fitness built up, even though I didn't run through the pregnancy. And that was sort of my baseline fitness level, because what happened was I started running in June. I set the record in the very beginning of November. And between those two times, I got sick like 3-4 times, because the kids at that point were in daycare and they brought all the germs home. So I tried to train and build up speed, but effectively it was like 2 steps forward, 1 step back. So I had a friend giving me some workouts, and then I'd like skip a week due to sickness. And I had never run a half marathon before.
That is insane. Now, you were doing this alongside a fundraiser for the El Camino NICU, where your triplets lived, for how long when they were initially?
They were there for about 3.5 weeks. Yeah.
Okay. So did that help you kind of, you know, get you through those times of sickness or kind of adversity there, that fundraiser?
Yeah. You know, I kind of wanted to have a larger reason other than just me breaking a record. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, I set up a fundraiser for both our NICU and something called Project Sweet Peas, which is a nationwide program that helps families with babies in NICUs. And I didn't really feel comfortable, I guess, drawing attention just to myself. And so I felt like if the attention were on something else and for a good cause, then that made me feel better about the whole thing.
And we will link to Project Sweet Peas in the show notes. People can click on details and go right to that link. Let me not glide over the fact, though, that you said this was your first half marathon. So you guys, are you hearing this? Not only did she break the 2-hour mark, but she's effectively pushing, what was the total weight at that point? Like 120, 130 pounds?
I think it was more like 110, actually. Yeah. It was pretty light. Compared to what I'm pushing now, it was pretty light. Yeah.
That is wild. So tell me about, okay, so half marathon, Guinness World Record. Most people would call it a day. I know from experience. What made you want to set the marathon record and then break your own record?
Well, so there's another mom out there who I found pretty inspiring. Her name is Teresa Marie Pitts. Mm-hmm. And she's out in Montana. She also broke the half marathon record in the months leading up to me. In fact, I believe she broke it twice. She broke her own record and yours. She actually has 8 children. She ran with 3 of them, though. And she established a mark for the full marathon. And I was pretty inspired by that. Now, the full marathon was another race that I had never, ever done. No clue, but I thought, well, I just did my first half marathon and it went pretty well. Maybe I should up the ante a little bit.
Oh, if people could, I am laughing because, are you guys hearing this? Anne-Marie did her first half marathon pushing 110 pounds worth of baby and stroller, and now she wants to do her first full marathon to achieve a Guinness World Record, again, pushing the babies and the stroller. This is amazing.
Yeah, I think, honestly, part of it was that we were well into these nap time stroller rides every weekend. I'd be running like 1 to 2 hours a day so they could sleep. And I was just
kind of
like,
the power of a nap.
I need a greater
nap for a mom
than just napping. But that was a hard one, I have to say, because I looked for a marathon that would take us. Mm-hmm. And I thought I had one. I was in pretty good shape like 6 weeks after I ran the half marathon. I was going up in distance, you know, like I did 16 miles. That went pretty well. And I thought I had a marathon actually down in the LA area, but the race course went on a path by the ocean that was not as wide as the road. And I went back and forth with the race director, and ultimately the director said, no, you know, we just can't have a stroller that large in our race. And I was kind of bummed. So I kept looking around. It's very hard to find races of any length that will let a triple stroller in because they consider it a security hazard for the other runners. Even though
so most people listening have never done a Guinness World Record application, but for the running one with strollers specifically, a lot of criticism happens. Folks think it's a safety on the course, like, this is a hazard. Oh no, y'all. If you see somebody out there like Anne Marie who is running with a stroller or setting a record for sure, there's been a lot of dialogue with the race director, with the course certification folks. We are supposed to be there. And there's a lot that happens behind the scenes. It's not like you just put three kids in a stroller and decide to race one day. A lot happens beforehand.
Yeah. So ultimately I found one with really nice race directors in Modesto, California in March 2018. And like you said, in all my races, I work with the directors. They specifically allow me to start in the front and off to the side. So the fast people are never bothered by us. Right. And so the fast people go right by. And more importantly, the people who are a little bit faster than us and come from behind see us and they can go around rather than me surprising them with my 4 foot. We call it the tank, actually.
Very good.
But it's kind of crazy because I had this marathon idea and I really didn't know if I could pull it off. And we just all winter, we just kept getting sick because germs, they come home and they multiply by 3 and you go down for weeks on end. So I was in this dialogue, but I told the directors, I'm going to be quite honest. Like, I'm not going to register until the very last minute. And I do not know if I'm going to show up. So like, don't even announce that I'm doing this. In fact, I didn't do the fundraiser the second time. I was so unsure if this was going to happen. I didn't tell anyone at all. In fact, I didn't even tell the woman who was my de facto coach who was sending me training plans. I didn't even tell her I was thinking that I was going to do it.
Wow.
So I registered. The race was on Sunday in March 2018. I registered on Friday. And I said, let's do it.
I'm curious. Okay, so not everybody can relate to being up for a Guinness World Record or stroller running with over 100 pounds worth of babies. But we can all relate to sometimes there's a really great thing in terms of social accountability, right? Hey, guys, I'm going to do this race. This is my intention. Do you feel like it helped you to take that out, like that factor out, i.e. there is no social pressure on me. If I want to grind and do this, I can do it.
Yeah, because what happened during the first race, there was so much pressure on me because I had announced it that I'm going to do it. And I did accomplish it. But the whole week before, I was in like this state of almost panic and it was not pleasant. And so I thought, I don't really want to go through this again because in fact, what I thought was going to be a not too hard to accomplish task was made even harder by the fact that a week or two before my half marathon record, someone lowered the time substantially. And so suddenly it was like, not only have I announced, like, I'm going to do this, but suddenly it's a lot harder. And I just kind of freaked out. And I thought, all right, if I do the marathon, I'm just going to like do it for me and the kids and tell people after the fact, which is what I did.
Okay. So that was the 4:06.
Yeah, so that was my first marathon ever.
I'm laughing, but I mean, so many people, right? Oprah did a marathon in 4:35. P. Diddy did one in 4:24. These are times that recreational runners will shoot for. And Anne-Marie has done a 4:06 with her stroller. Talk to me a little bit about your most recent race attempt. That was a very, very speedy 10K effort.
That's right. These stroller races are just, they're fun, but I also came to recognize along the way that they're very inspiring to other moms and folks out there for the most part. And that's something that I didn't really think about when I first did them. And so after I did a few and people were like, wow, check this out. Like, I got to get out and run. Look at this lady. I was like, wow, this is pretty neat. And, I had this slight problem, which I had a half marathon record, a full marathon record, and I did do a second half marathon, but it was not clear whether it would be approved because there was a big issue with the course certification. So I had 2 certificates and 3 kids, and I was like, I am not going to live that up. what am I going to do? You know, they're going to go off.
You can just buy a duplicate certificate, right? Oh, no, she's going to break another record.
Yeah, so I was like, well, I thought the third one was my second half marathon, but then I was like, I don't know if I'm going to get that. And I'm never going to break the half marathon again because a really fast lady went and broke my time eventually. So I thought, well, and the marathon, like, oh, forget that. I'm never doing that again either. That was like 4 hours of pushing kids and they're now toddlers. Like, who would do that? But the 10K was something that existed at other for other strollers, double and single, but not the triple. So I decided I'm going to establish it just like you, Susie, established the half marathon. That'll be like no problem, right? You know, they'll give me a time limit. It won't be too hard. I'll just go out and do it, and then we'll get our 3 certificates, and all the kids can be happy when they grow up and have a plaque on their wall, you know. But in the meantime, I applied, and they gave me the go-ahead. Someone else went out and broke it before I had a chance to race.
This is the second time the time standard has been lowered for you, and the pressure has upped.
Exactly. So... And by the time I had a race lined up, and I thought I was running to break 50 minutes, someone lowered it by a minute, which for a 10K is significant. And right. And 10K is a distance I've done before. And so I'll tell you, when I was training for the half marathon, I did 2 10Ks. I finished in 52 minutes in both of them. When the kids were tiny. So I was like, again, I like challenges, as you can see, but I was not at all convinced.
But lining up to the starting line, you're like 49 minutes. This is aggressive.
Yeah. Well, so I'll tell you a little secret though. I was so concerned that I couldn't do it that I went and made myself a practice 10K course. It's hard to find an uninterrupted 10K in a busy suburban area where I am, but I found a bike trail, and it was not optimal. It was pretty hilly and curvy and stuff. But I trained on it once. I did not make the time. And then 2 weeks later, I went back, and I managed to hit 49 just barely. So I was like, okay, at least I backed off on the pressure a little bit. But
race day, you really nailed it, because what is pending currently as of the – time of this recording is 47:10.
Yeah, so it turns out, for all of you who are interested in racing with strollers, the course really matters. The hills, take the hills out, flat, smooth, open road, no wind. It makes a huge difference, because when that wind blows, my stroller is like a parachute. And that's actually why it's so hard to find good races to set records on, because where I live, we're by the water. And anytime you go by the water, like, forget it. So I have to find inland races with nice directors and also with courses that are certified by the USA Track and Field. So it's actually super hard to find.
So ours was very hilly. Ours was almost a uphill designation. We missed it by about 20 feet, I think, because the consideration for URI is, well, do I travel somewhere pancake flat or do I let the kids sleep in their bed the night before?
Exactly.
So
that was the great thing about this 10K. It was the last two races I've done have been within 20, 30 minutes of home. So we lucked out with that. Yep.
Smart woman. All right. Well, Anne-Marie, I could talk to you all day long, world record holder multiple times that you are. I do want to wrap up here, though, and be respectful of your time, because one of the things I'm most impressed by, you are a working mom who has triplets and does these amazing things on the race course. And I don't want to underestimate that as well. You're passionate about your career and you're making strides there as well. Tell me, if you could go back 10 years, what is a piece of advice that you would give yourself?
Yeah. You know, I would tell myself to chill out and have more fun. Honestly, I was so focused on my education, my studies, and I almost like I enjoyed athletics, rowing, running, but I was so focused on being one thing, which was an astronomer, that I felt like I had to hide the rest. And now I'm not doing that. I'm like, yay, I work at NASA, I run, I'm a mom, and that's like all of those things are me. And it's taken me a while to actually show that to people, because it's when you're in scientific research, academics, university culture is such that they want you to be really good at one thing. And if you go out and do other things that you're good at, it's almost like you look distracted. And I latched onto that idea for a while. Now I've realized, no, you know, I am the happiest person when I do all of these things and balance my time well between them, between the family and all that. And I wish I'd figured that out 10 years ago, because it's just so much more enjoyable now.
I hope people are hearing you. I know the listeners of this show, and I think there are a lot of moms that are stuck in that, meaning that their entire identity is in motherhood and they don't make room to enjoy the other things. So I hope they're hearing themselves paralleled in what you're describing with your career there.
Yeah, it's very important to get me time. And I like to tell people, you know, my kids are happy because I put the proverbial oxygen mask on myself first before I put it on them. And, you know, I enjoy running. It's good for them, but it makes me happy, which then makes me a better mom, I think, for it.
Absolutely. I don't know of a better place to leave this off. Anne-Marie, thank you so much for coming on and sharing with your experience about being a triplet mom runner who's also a working professional. I feel so blessed that we connected many years ago, and I look forward to staying connected as our triplets grow up.
Yeah. Well, thanks. I really appreciate talking to you. That was fun.
Awesome. Bye, Anne-Marie. Thank you very much.
So many nuggets in this episode. I hope you guys heard Anne-Marie when she discussed the importance of modeling healthy behavior. What if she had never seen that cross-country team running or known who Lynn Jennings was? I hope you heard her when she talked about her adversity and how she turned those challenges into triumphs with her Guinness World Records. I also hope that you heard that last segment where she talked about being caught up in an identity and learning to relax and have fun with the other areas of her life. Thank you so much, Anne-Marie. I am honored to have an athlete like yourself come on the Run Lift Mom podcast. Until I get in your earpiece again, remember, for while bodily training is of some value, godliness is of value in every way, as it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come. That's from 1 Timothy 4:8, and this has been the Run Lift Mom podcast. Hey, Run Lift Mom listeners, you know I'm the mom of 4 kids under age 5, and therefore, I am always looking for ways to work smart, not hard. Anchor is the smartest way to make a podcast. Let me tell you why. First of all, there are creation tools that allow you to record and edit your podcast right from your phone or computer, but Anchor will also distribute your podcast for you, so then it can be heard on places like Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and a whole lot more. You can make money from your podcast with no minimum listenership. It is quite literally everything you need all in one place. And y'all, it's free. So download the free Anchor app or go to anchor.fm to get started. It's time for the Zaya Active item of the week. And this week, it's the Racer Light and Tight High-Rise Crop. No matter what size you are, from 0 to 18, the inseam on these is 17 inches. The shorter length is perfect for summer, but it's that same light and tight blend that you love. It's compressive, it performs, it makes you feel sucked in. I love this pattern because it does mask lumps and bumps. It's also extremely versatile as a neutral print. Click details. You'll see the link to these in the show notes. That's the Racer Light and Tight High Rise Crop, 17 inches. Thank you for your support of the Run Lift Mom podcast. This is a passion project for me that began in February of 2019 and now has over 10,000 listens. It's amazing. This is where I uplift other women and create communities around the areas of running, lifting, and motherhood. If you haven't yet done so already, please rate, review, and subscribe. That helps folks find the podcast and it keeps this passion project going. I am beyond excited to announce that Red H Nutrition is an official partner of the Run Lift Mom podcast. I've been a Red H sponsored athlete since November of 2018, which means that I've trained for multiple marathons, 100K trail race, while using these products to supplement my training as well as on race day. And I think that you can take it to the bank. They work. Some of my favorites are Super Greens, Super Flexi, and ZenRem, but you can click on details in the show notes to shop Red H Nutrition and check it out for yourself. Use code RUNLIFTMOM, that's RUNLIFTMOM, just like the name of this show, to save 10%. Again, just click on details in your show notes, shop Red H Nutrition, and then use code RUNLIFTMOM at checkout for 10% off.